Well, good evening and welcome to Wednesday night. If you checked Facebook this afternoon, you may have noticed we're not going to be looking at the Exodus tonight or the time in the wilderness. It's because it's Easter week and I've been doing a lot of reading and studying on the passion of Christ and the resurrection. And so decided that we would focus in tonight on the resurrection or the events of the passion. That's what we'll do when we get to Bible study in a few minutes. So I'm going to go ahead and prepare you. Those of you who are with me live or in person tonight. And Tim, if you can help me out, if we have anybody online that wants to ask questions about the Passion Week scriptures, they can ask those, but you'll have to ask it for them because I'm not going to be following along on my phone because I get too confused when I try that. So you have to flag me down and share a question with me. But if you have questions you want to ask, my goal tonight is try to answer some questions. Between the group of us who are gathered here, we'll try to figure out what we don't know. And Polly, you are banned. You can only ask questions if nobody else does. Polly always asks me stuff I can't answer. That's why she's banned. She's not really banned. She knows I'm picking on her. So I really want to start with some prayer updates, prayer requests. I didn't send out an email so far this week just because I don't really have a whole lot of update from Sunday. But I'll give you a few things I do know, and they're not major changes or anything. But Tom Howard is 2 weeks completed on his 5 weeks of treatment, so three to go. Everything has gone very well, and he meets with his oncologist tomorrow just to track progress, but everything seems to be going really good, so Tom's happy. Mary Hendrons did bring her dad home, Buck, from the nursing home. He is now back with her where he lives, and she's given the care that he needs. And so she said he really is doing much better, no anxiety, not having to be medicated for anxiety and those kind of things that were extras because of being out of his environment. So that was a big praise for them. We did hear Sunday morning that Gene Polk, Mr. Gene, is back under cancer treatment again. So we need to keep him in our prayers. We'll get more details coming soon from the family, but you know, he's been in remission for a while, kind of on and off, and he's back active in with the cancer. So we need to start adding Gene back to our prayers, and the family, like I say, will give us more updates here shortly as they kind of figure out what the treatment process will be and what this particular route means. I'm not sure if we said it Sunday morning or not, so I can't remember when Ken told me, but Ken did get to meet with his oncologist, Ken Lobb, and they're just going to do a watch and wait with Ken, so no treatment at this time. And so that's kind of what he expected and wanted, but it's a positive that it's real early, and it's kind of one of those things that most men will die or with that type of cancer will die with it, not from it. And so we can still keep Ken in our prayers. Dave Wilson got a mixed report from Deb, his wife, on his health. So improvement is he has been able to sleep about 3 hours a night with some medication, or 3 hours in a stretch with some medication, but he's groggy more often. So kind of a mixed answer there. They do not have their genetic testing back to know if he's eligible for genotherapy. They are treating with cancer with radiation, and that seems to be effective right now. And so they're hoping to shrink the tumors enough that his pain will dissipate, and they feel very positive about that. And so those were some good things. The best thing from Deb was he's been able to preach the last two Sundays, share the gospel, teach how to share the gospel, just very thankful that he's able to continue the work the Lord's called him to. And so, update on Dave. Dave's our missionary back home, you know, permanently now in the States, but was our missionary in Ecuador for a number of years and got us started going there. And got to FaceTime with Javi today. And they were in Montalvo. So got to talk to Guillermo, got to talk to Martin, a couple of the guys who run the church there. These are deacons. They're not pastors, but they have kept the church going for several years now without a pastor, and they're doing well. They're passing out Bibles. They've got the audio Bibles to pass out. They have children's like coloring book Easter things, and so it was good to connect with them briefly. It was brief because we lost our signal and didn't get to finish our conversations, but it was good to have a face-to-face with them. You can keep them in your prayers. They'll be down there, I think, the rest of today, and then maybe come back tomorrow to their where they live. They'll be leaving, maybe. And so there's some pictures on Facebook if you are part of the Missions Connections group of them ministering. You got some with Pastor Patricio and then some in Montalvo as well. So keep them all in your prayers. It is Easter season or resurrection season, Passover season, whichever you prefer, which is also Annie Armstrong season. And so Annie Armstrong is the name of our offering for our North American missionaries that we do every year during this Easter season. So pray about how you can give and support our missionaries. There is a big push this year and for the next 5 years to get back to basics in the Southern Baptist Convention of what holds us together, and to they're really trying to make an attempt to stop being distracted by all the urgencies of the moment. Anybody ever had an urgency of the moment? I call them squirrels. I got lots of them. Cell phones. You know, there's so much in the news, there's so much in the world, and so easy to get off task. So many secondary and tertiary debates that take primary focus. The Southern Baptist Convention was formed to preach the gospel, to send missionaries, and to do it together with cooperating churches. In the article I was reading today that was talking about, there were five things they wanted to focus on. Another one was baptisms, salvations that lead to baptisms, and then discipleship, all that combined. I can't remember what all five were, but basically some of those kind of things. And giving, not giving of the people, but also the giving of the churches to the ministry and the missions that the cooperative program allows us to do. But the author, I think it was Jeff Iorg, who's the Golden Gate Seminary president, he quoted somebody else, another missionary from another mission sending agency. And he said that the people who most take for granted the benefits of the cooperative program are Southern Baptists. He says, you talk to any other missions sending agency or missionary, they understand the value of what we do as an organization in fully supporting our missionaries. So one of the goals is to add at least 500 missionaries to the international mission field in the next 5 years. To add, I forget the number of churches, but to get the number of local congregations over 50,000 again, which we've been there before. We've been way over that. We're down in total number of congregations. So to increase that. And so some of these focuses that should be priorities because they're gospel-centered and they only happen through cooperation. So I'll throw that out there as we talk about Annie Armstrong. Pray for our missions and our ministries and our cooperative program, our mission boards, our specific face and name to that is Emilio Hernandez, Gaspar. Emilio pastors on the west side of Indianapolis. He's a church planter. We've been supporting him for several years now, and so just need to be praying for him. I've talked a lot already on prayer and prayer needs, and I'm sure there are some others that I've missed, or I'll take a few praises intermixed if you have those as well. So anything that we need to do on prayer? Yeah, Jim. Yes. Okay, so we were asked Sunday, one of the services, about Easter services, like the Monday, Thursday, or Good Friday. Jim shared that St. James Lutheran Church here in town will be doing those services Thursday, or 7 o'clock each night. So if you're interested, that's one place you can go. I'm fairly sure that, I don't know the times, but... Trinity United Methodist is doing Holy Week services. St. Michael's Catholic does Holy Week services. I don't know who all's doing them this year, but there may be a few if it's something you're interested in. Good Friday at Shirley Wilkinson. What do you know? What time, Rick? 7 p.m. Andy. Browns Chapel doing Good Friday as well. Okay. You know what time Good Browns Chapel is? Okay. Man, I just love to hear Pastor Theo talk. He's got a great voice. From the is it Virgin Islands? Do you remember? One of the islands, one of the Caribbean islands. He's just got this great bass voice. And so you can't skip Sunday mornings, but if you want to go on Good Friday. All right. Well, let me pray for us, and we'll get into some questions and into the Word, and we'll see what we can put together, see if we can make the Passion Week make sense. Let's pray. Father, I thank you tonight that we can be together in your house to focus on this Passion Week, the week that we look at and think about, pray for, meditate on the things that Jesus went through for us. Lord, I'm thankful. As I think all Christians are. Not only that you resurrected from the dead, but that you are willing to sacrifice and suffer for us. Help us to appreciate all that you have done, all that you went through, and all that you're continuing to do. We thank you tonight for the many praises we've been able to share, but we also continue to lift up the prayer requests that are before us. And the many that are not mentioned and are strong on our hearts. Lord, we ask that you would bless each and every person who hears or participates in these studies and in this time of prayer. We ask that you would reveal yourself in a way that will amaze us. Help us be willing to pray prayers that are greater than we could ask or imagine so that you will be glorified as you meet our needs through your glorious riches, through your ability. Through your power. Father, I thank you for a church that supports missions and ministry. I thank you for a church that allows us to go on the mission field and serve churches like Montalvo in Ecuador. Support churches like Emilio's on the west side. Be a part of all the many things that you allow us to do as Southern Baptists. Be with our missionaries around the globe. Lord, we are so thankful that we can rightly claim the sun never sets on the work that you're doing through your Baptist brothers and sisters. Lord, I thank you that this Sunday we have an opportunity to worship you. For you are able to defeat death. You are able to bring life not only to yourself but to all who will believe. Thank you for an opportunity to celebrate the reality that you are risen. And we have hope. Tonight, Lord, teach us. Help to answer any questions we may have or to be able to share any thoughts that are precious to us about the Passion Week or the Easter season. Maybe we encourage one another through this time together, just focusing in on all that you have done. So bless this time together. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, men and women, boys and girls, we are in a lot of passages, so we can be anywhere you need to be, want to be. We are not in Exodus, Numbers, or Deuteronomy, I don't think. I'm open to Matthew chapter 26 right now in my Bible. I'm going to probably just tell a little bit of the Easter story, but really what I want you to do, what I want to ask you is, what part of the story is special to you, and or do you have questions about the Easter story, the passion story of Christ, from the synoptics, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, or from John, the Gospel of John, and let's see what we can do together. I'm not going to promise I know all the answers to all the questions, but we'll do the best we can. I hope you've already been studying this week, so this won't be new to you. But I know Paul was saying he asked the kids at chapel today if they had questions. He said their hands all shot up. They were full of questions. I have my 3- and 4-year-olds. They didn't have any questions. After I told them the Easter story, I asked them what the most important thing to remember about Easter is. And it was that you get lots of candy. You can spend 20 minutes telling them all about how Jesus rose from the grave and he did a miracle and he had power over death and he's preparing heaven so we can be with him someday when it's our turn to die and how God loved us and he showed us his love because Jesus had power over death and he didn't stay in the tomb and he now lives in heaven. And what's the most important thing that we need to remember about Easter? You get lots of candy. I did my best, guys. I'm not sure I get a check mark on that Easter lesson today, though. Dottie? Yeah. Yeah, so Dottie mentioned the thing that says Christianity apart from everybody else is our risen Savior. Nobody else has that. And that separates us from religion and relationship. He's alive, and he's called us to be with him, connected to him. Yeah. Yeah, it is a good lesson. And we have lots of parents that do this over the years. I mean, it's not a bunch at one time, but we hear this, you know, most years from somebody is the kids are brought to church because the parents want or to the daycare to be schooled in a religious setting or in a faith-based setting because they want their kids to be taught about the Bible. But if you don't teach it at home, there's a good chance it won't take with the kid. And so the parents need to model the behavior they expect the kids to learn. Yeah, I get people get upset with me sometimes because I still say Easter. I grew up celebrating Easter. I know what Easter means. I think most people with any faith connection actually understand what Easter means. And if you want to use Resurrection Day, you are more right. And it's a good thing to use. But please don't get mad at me for saying Easter. Because it's about the resurrection of Christ. It's a date on the calendar. It's been around for a long time. I know it's not the original, but it has been around for a long time. And yes, when I use the word Easter, I mean Jesus came out of the tomb alive. And so I think sometimes we get too sensitive as Christians. It's one of those things like Jeff Iorg was talking about. We get caught up in the wrong things to stay focused on the right things. But yes, you are more right to use Resurrection Day than to use Easter. But if you hear Easter, don't get offended. Just tell them, hey, Easter's about Jesus coming out of the tomb. It's Resurrection Day. Got to hear the word. Got to be challenged. We got to send. We got to do a better job of calling out the called. Supporting them. God's called them to. Good. Let's get into Easter story a little bit. I want to read a little bit to you. Y'all love when I read to you, right? All right. So chapter 26 of Matthew. When Jesus is finished saying all these things, he told his disciples, you know, the Passover takes place after 2 days, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. the chief priests and the elders of the people, they assembled in the courtyard of the high priest who was named Caiaphas, and they conspired to arrest Jesus in a treacherous way and kill him. I'm in now Matthew 26, verse 5. Not during, they said, so there won't be rioting among the people. While Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman approached with an alabaster jar, very expensive perfume. I'm going to skip a little bit here. She pours the perfume on him. She weeps over his feet. Some get upset because, again, he's wasting money, right? But Jesus is saying it's okay to worship at this time. Verse 17, on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and they asked, where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover? Go into the city to a certain man, he said, and tell him, the teacher says, my time is near. I am celebrating the Passover at your place with my disciples. So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared Passover. When evening came, he was reclining at the table with the 12. While they were eating, he said, truly I tell you, one of you will betray me. Deeply distressed, each one began to say to him, surely not I, Lord. He replied, the one who dipped his hand in the bowl, he will betray me. The Son of Man will go, just as it is written about him. But woe to that man whom the Son of Man is by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for him had he not been born. Better he'd not been bored too, because then he may have been busy doing the right things. I don't know. But better that he'd not been born. Verse 25, Judas, his betrayer, replied, surely not I, Rabbi. You have said it, he told him. We get into the First Lord's Supper. Peter and his denial being predicted. Verse 36 takes us to the prayer in the garden. Jesus says, sit here while I go over there and pray. The guys that he takes with him, they fall asleep, taking Peter and the sons of Zebedee three times. And then after verse 44, the third time, after leaving them, he went away and prayed the third time, saying the same thing once more. And then he came to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? See, the time is near. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let's go. See, my betrayer is near. By the way, what did Jesus say to God in the garden? Is there any other way that this can be done? Not my will, but thy will be done. He's willing. Judas betrays Jesus with a kiss. Next little section there. And Jesus is arrested. I want to pick up in verse 50. Friend, Jesus asked him, why have you come? Then they came up, took hold of Jesus and arrested him. And at that moment, one of those who was with Jesus reached out his hand, drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus told him, put your sword back in its place, because all who take up the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will provide me here and now with more than 12 legions of angels? How then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way? That time Jesus said to the crowds, have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a criminal to capture me? Every day I used to sit teaching in the temple, and you did not arrest me. But this has happened so that the writings of the prophets will be fulfilled. Then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. Jesus faces the Sanhedrin. Peter denies him. We get in chapter 27. He's handed over to Pilate. We get a section there in chapter 27 where Judas hangs himself. By the way, this is the reason we never do that flip your Bible, stick your finger down, and say, this is what God wants for me today. Because you might land in Matthew 27 and Judas goes and hangs himself. That's not God's plan for your life. I don't like roulette scripture reading. God, show me your will. No, you pray, you meditate, you do read scripture, absolutely. But that can be very dangerous. I've heard stories along those lines for years. I don't know if any of them are actually true. But let's not test it, okay? Jesus faces the governor. And then he gets asked, do you want Jesus or Barabbas? They're given the option. By the way, if we get into the other synoptic gospels, Matt, Mark, and Luke, there's other events included as you go through all of this. As well as John, he's got his own account in there. And so a lot that happens, mocked by the military, crucified between the criminals. And then we get to the death itself, hung on the cross in the late morning, earthquake and darkness. Jesus, seven last words from the cross, if you want to go into that aspect. Punctured in his side, taken off the cross and laid in a borrowed tomb. You get names, Joseph of Arimathea and guy from John chapter 3. Nicodemus, thank you. Taking Jesus' body. I can tell you where he's found. I just can't tell you who he is. Laying him in the tomb. Guess who knew where the tomb of Jesus was? Everybody. Kind of like going over to Park Cemetery in Greenfield. You know where Grandma and Grandpa was, right? Or is. Or at least where their body is. Why? Because you were there when they were placed. And you've been there to see aunts and uncles and relatives. And you know your way around. This was not some magical hidden tomb somewhere where they couldn't find it or find their way back to it. Or where they got confused and thought, oh, he was over here. Or maybe he was over there. Or I really don't remember where he was. I'll just pick one and roll a stone away and see if he's still there. It didn't happen that way. Oh, that's what some of the scoffers want us to believe. That they didn't really know where he was supposed to be. They knew. And they went. Sunday morning, first day of the week, what'd they find? An empty tomb. Angel says, he's not here. He is risen. All right, I probably told you as much of the story as I need to and read a little bit of it. Did I jog your memory, make you think of any questions you might have? I just stuck with the Gospel of Matthew. You can ask from anywhere, or we can look it up and find it. David. Yes. Yeah, I intentionally want to bring out the sword because, yeah, arm yourself and come with me. So let me ask, you may not be finished, but let me ask, because it's a good road to go down, why did Jesus say arm yourself? Why did Jesus say arm yourself? Dan. It's one way to get their attention because they weren't taking him serious about the things he was telling them. Okay? Anybody else? Other ideas? Other thoughts? I've got one. I don't know if I'm right, but I got one. Yeah, that would have been the last miracle prior to resurrection. Paul, you got any brilliant wisdom? Sword's not needed while he's still with him. He's got his legion of angels. But he's going to be disappearing. Good. What did they want their Messiah to be? And what did they think their Messiah should be? A conqueror. A military leader. Jesus says, get your swords. They maybe thought, oh, it's finally here. They're ready to resist. If you remember last week, we talked about on Sunday morning, this past Sunday, we talked about lost my train of thought. Let me get back to it. They were going with Jesus to Jerusalem with the expectation of dying. When they left to go see Lazarus, he's going to Jerusalem. Let's go with him. We'll die with him. They had this expectation of fighting to the death. They're ready in that moment, which is really kind of interesting. Peter's willing to take the sword and die by Jesus' side in the garden. But a few hours after, into the trial, he's denying Jesus, not willing to die for him anymore. Well, here's why, I think. This is what I think. I think Jesus had him bring the sword so he could specifically tell him to put the sword down. You want a Messiah who's gonna lead rebellion, an uprising, a revolt. I'm not your guy. Peter, put it down. Your ear's healed. It's back on. We're not going that route. Y'all wanted it. I told you to bring your sword so I could. I think it was so I could prove the point. That's not the way we're doing this. But it also causes Peter to have some doubts, doesn't it? You know, sometimes the more you doubt and then get the right answer, work through those doubts to get to the right answer, the stronger your faith becomes. I think Jesus just gave him a faith strengthening opportunity. Now, I'm sure there's more to it than just what I've said, so I'm willing to take other suggestions. Yeah, why'd they all run if they're so willing to fight and die? Yeah. You know, being ready to fight and die is, okay, easy application here. You can say anything you want to any bully's face when you're on Facebook. But stare them eye to eye, and you'll see a lot of people turn around and walk away. We have a whole lot of gusto when we have a little bit of anonymity. Well, back when they were, you know, hanging out around the fire with Jesus saying, oh, we got a few days before we need to go to Judea. They're ready to die. They get to Judea and they're facing the soldiers. Oh, we're not so sure we're ready for this fight. You know, especially after Jesus says, put your knife down. We're not doing that. Dottie. Yeah. Right. They missed the whole suffering servant in Isaiah 53. They missed all that. Yep. Yep, 14th chapter of Mark. 40th, verse 43. Yeah. Yeah. Now, Judas is trying to force the hand in a sense of Jesus. Here he is, guys. Go get him. But keep him safe. It's interesting that he says keep him safe. He didn't want him dead. And he probably thought, hey, my guys are here ready to fight. Well, I'll join with them if it turns out that way. If not, then I'll side with over here. Judas is kind of watching out for himself. There's some interesting things in the whole Judas story. Yeah. Yeah. Not going to be an all-out battle. Yeah. So in Mark, only two swords were presented. Jesus says, that's enough. Judas's history was that of a zealot, part of the movement to overthrow the Romans, and quite possibly part of Barabbas's group. And that's what he was arrested for. He was a rabble rouser. He was a rioter, an insurrectionist. Yeah. So when all of your hopes are squashed, stepped on, destroyed, Jesus is going to be this new king. He's coming to Jerusalem with great pomp and circumstance. And Dottie said it a minute ago. I don't think I repeated it. But the Pharisees and the Romans, they're not really worried about Jesus as much as they are the crowds that Jesus commands. It's a movement. They want to stop the movement. The movement wants Jesus to continue, but to amplify militarily or insurrection a cause that they find dear. But Jesus keeps coming back to his purpose. And one of the reasons I mentioned in our prayer time, the Southern Baptist Convention is I love that idea of returning to our purpose. How often do we lose focus on who we are and what we're about? And we end up going down paths that don't bring us joy, don't bring us happiness, don't bring us satisfaction. Without bad intent, we just lose focus on what really is most important. Jesus is bringing them back to center, but it's also driving away or a wedge between some who wanted something very specifically in the reality of who he is. They can't reconcile the suffering servant, the Isaiah 53, going to be crucified, got to die on the cross. They can't reconcile that to what they've always wanted, longed for, looked for, what they thought he was. We talked about that a little bit Sunday morning, is who is the Jesus we've created in our minds, and how do we get back to the Jesus of Scripture? Stay there. And I think it's a continual reset button we have to push. We have to remind ourselves or be reminded to do that. That's why churches used to have revival every year. Somebody different would come in and preach the same thing the preacher had been saying all year, and everybody get all excited about it. And the preacher goes home and he's like, I've told them that a dozen times. They didn't listen to me. He comes in and in 30 minutes, everybody's life's changed. What that is? That's a preacher feeling self-pity when he should be celebrating God used somebody else to do something amazing. We all do it though, because why? We're all self-centered. Just giving you a little look into the life of Roger. All right. Another question or comment or oh no, you guys got to hurry up. Polly got in before you. All right, Polly, go ahead. Back in Matthew. Verse 22, Matthew 26, verse 22. Yeah. Not much self-reflection there, is there? So she's pointing out that the scripture says Jesus asked the question in verse 21. Or makes the statement, truly I tell you, one of you will betray me. And they kind of go around the room. Verse 22 says, deeply distressed, each one began to say, surely not I, Lord. There's no introspection there. There's no looking inside of oneself saying, could it be me? Have I missed something about myself? But rather, they're being awful certain of where they stand before the Lord. Now I want you to be certain in the sense of salvation. But anytime we begin to be certain in sense of our holiness or our purity, we probably need a better mirror. Go buy some Windex, spray it on, you know, rub it down good, because something's wrong if you're not, if you think you're as good as you can get and there's no way Satan can get hold of you, you need to reflect a little bit better. What comes before the fall? Pride. Yeah. Yeah. You said it triggered a thought. So David says that the guy is not understanding that Jesus is going to die, but he's not going to die the way they think he is. They think he's going to die, you know, maybe battle or something like that, and they're all ready to go. But he's not going to die the way they think he's going to die. He's going to die in a unique way, even though it's a prophesied way, something that they never put together. But remember, the sons of Zebedee had a little argument, didn't they? Who's going to sit on the right hand? Who's going to sit on the left-hand side of Jesus? And Mama got involved. Mama, let me tell you about your sons. When God calls them, you need to get uninvolved, and God needs to get more involved. or you need to get less involved. Your job becomes prayer time, and God's job becomes leader time. Because what happens when mama gets involved? The boys want to sit on the right and left hand of Christ, and what's Jesus ask them? He says, it's not mine to give, but then he says, in essence, it's, do you really want this? What's the words he says? Can you drink from my cup? Which cup is Jesus going to drink from? Because remember what he says to his father in the garden. Can you take this cup away from me? The cup of bitterness. The cup of death. The cup of suffering. The cup of agony. Oh, by the way, guess how most of the apostles died. Agony. Murdered. Crucified, burned alive, skinned, quartered. It wasn't fun to be an apostle of Jesus, but they all saw their faith through to the end because they realized after the resurrection that there was no greater glory than to know the Father and to serve Him. And they were willing to die that way because they then understood that closeness to the Father. Yeah. 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 We believe David mentioned Fox's Book of Martyrs. But we believe John was the only one to die of natural causes. Of course, he died of natural causes, but where was he? In exile. Yeah. The Lord had protected him up to that, you know. To that point. But it wasn't an easy life nonetheless. But it was a valuable life. Yeah. Second Corinthians 13:5, Paul's teaching on communion. What was the verse number? Yeah, 2 Corinthians 13:5. Not the passage I thought we were going to. So, but what he says, what Larry read to us was, test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves, which is the same thing that we're told during communion we're supposed to do, right? Examine ourselves so we don't fall into sin. Or do you not yourselves not recognize that Jesus Christ is in you? But we should be constantly testing ourselves and making sure we're right with the Lord. Another question. Paulie, did we answer you or kind of deal with your issue? Because I get sidetracked so easy. Okay. Yep. Oh, yeah. Son of. Yeah, Barabbas was a real guy. Yeah, so if we go back into Hebrew, names are, of course, spellings are all different and everything, but Bar, son of, so it is Bar Abbas, basically. There's some interesting studies around the names, particularly that name, but in this set of events that I'm not prepared to, I'd have to go back and study on to give any more insight. But no, there was not a confusion of who are we cheering for. Barabbas was a popular insurrectionist, well known, and they would have both been standing there, Jesus and Barabbas, to be seen. So they knew who they were cheering for. Absolutely, which is a good question, because it could look at the translation. Are they cheering for their father, the son of the father, or are they cheering for Jesus? That was his taken name for his work he was doing. there's a lot of history there that and you got now you may end up with Pauly asking questions I can't answer. Who was the other person that used to ask questions I can't answer? We had another. Somebody else used to do that. Always asked me something I didn't have a clue. Tough questions. Yeah, Dottie's done it a couple of times. She stumped me. It's not Stump Pastor Night, though. We're trying to learn. What's your favorite aspect or scriptural reference or part to study when it comes to Passover or Passion Week or... Are you talking about the high priestly prayer of Jesus in John, what is that, 17? 17, is that right? I've got it here. Yeah, John 17. We call it three-part high priestly prayer of Jesus. First part, he prays for himself. Second part, he prays for his disciples. Third part, he prays for all believers, those who would be one. I think that's what you're referring to there. Yeah, absolutely. He prayed for you. And shortly after that, you've got the betrayal. So that is kind of the same seat. John's elaborating on what the synoptics mention as a quick thing. So when Jesus goes off to pray three different times and the guys are sleeping, even I can stay awake for 5 minutes. But Jesus' prayers probably weren't 5-minute prayers as he talked to the Father. So there are probably three different watches of the night that he's praying through, which gives him the opportunity to have the more elaborate John 17 prayer time. And John was catnapping because apparently he heard some of it. Holy Spirit told him about it later. You're right. We don't want to neglect the work of the Holy Spirit in the writing of the Scripture. Yeah, they just finished Passover meal, so. Whoa. Dottie's favorite verse for resurrection is Job chapter 19. I'm going to miss you when you're gone. She's moving to Florida. You may read it. Sorry, I keep interrupting you, but. I know that my Redeemer lives and he shall stand at last on the earth. Now I get it. I did not know that was in Job. Ma'am, sir? Great hymn also. Yeah, good deal. Another question, another answer you've never been given or something you struggle with or a favorite passage. New discovery. Mark. Mark 16, verse 7. Peter is identified or singled out. Go tell the disciples and Peter. Why is Peter singled out there? Is he not a disciple? Okay. Yeah, so I don't want to say translation error. It was a translation issue of especially Peter or and Peter or sometimes the contractions and those kind of things don't translate well. So, yeah. Is there a reason Peter would be named individually? He'll become the head of the church. And he had been pointed out by Jesus or especially poured into by Jesus for that role. David? Yeah. Yeah. So it's especially Peter, because Peter especially needed to see Jesus and to hear from Jesus that he was forgiven. The others had run away from the cross except for John. But Peter actively denied Jesus. And he was crushed in his spirit. And Jesus wanted to make sure the other disciples did not alienate him because of that. And he did not want Peter to alienate himself because of that. Especially bring the one who's struggling through this because of that. Tim, did you have a question for me? Who'd you send it to? Nate, you got a question for me. Yeah, so part of the story. Jesus is crucified between two thieves. One of them rejects Jesus. The other says to him, basically, forgive me. Will you remember me when you enter your kingdom? Jesus says, today you'll be with me in paradise. What does that mean? And so, go ahead. Absolutely. All three died, but only two of them had a good ending to their death. So why in paradise? Why not in heaven? Is heaven and paradise the same thing? The answer is no, and that is correct. Rich man and Lazarus, parable or story that Jesus tells, the teaching of Jesus. Sheol, which was hell. Abraham's bosom, which is paradise. So, this is way oversimplifying, but just to way oversimplify this, until Jesus goes and prepares a place for us in heaven, John chapter 14, we don't have our permanent home in heaven. So all the Old Testament people who have died prior to Jesus completing the work of preparation are in the presence of the Father, but not in the permanent place that the Father is preparing for them, because Jesus hasn't yet done that work. So you have a difference between paradise and what we see in Revelation as the new heaven and the new earth and that permanent dwelling place. Post Christ, as Christians now, he's already resurrected, he's preparing the place for us. We're told in 2 Corinthians 5, absent from the body, present with Christ, we are inheriting that. But then there's also this whole time thing we have to deal with, because God doesn't operate bound by our time. And so don't want to get into that tonight, but that is a whole nother much bigger discussion. Did I have a hand over here for that before I come to you, Dottie? Yeah. Set the captives free. Yeah, so he's got 3 days on the cross, 40 days on the earth before he ascends to the right hand of the Father, which is where he prepares the place. And so there is a temporary, this is not purgatory. We are not teaching purgatory here. There's no lack of judgment where you have an opportunity to be even better and get some extra credit and maybe you can get in. It's not what we're dealing with. There's a time appointed a man to live and a time appointed for man to die and then judgment. That happened while Jesus was on the earth. He's teaching it as a matter of fact right now. And now we have the reality that Jesus has paid the price. He has become the sacrificial lamb. So our sins are forgiven through that. So it's opening up the temple curtain's now torn. It's opening up a whole new world of things. Theologically for us and understanding and realities. But there was a difference prior to the death, burial, resurrection, the ascension of Christ as far as what transpired upon death. Yeah. Yeah. So again, the story of rich man Lazarus, that gives us the clarity that Jesus brought to the situation. There's hell, and there's blessing. There's hell, and there's nothing in between, and there's no crossing over. He can never cross that gulf. Can not even for a drink of water, not a drop of water. There's no crossing the gulf. Once you're dead, it's too late to make your decision. So make it now. And that's really what Easter, Resurrection Day, is all about, isn't it? We got to make our decision. It's about the promise. There is hope in the reality of who Jesus is. He's a promise keeper. He says, I'll die and I'll rise. And he does. There's no denying it. There was no denying it in the first century. People try to deny it today, but that doesn't change the reality of it. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 13 through 15, it says, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But if he did not raise him from the dead are not raised. 1 Corinthians 15, 13 through 15. We're to be pitied if Jesus didn't resurrect from the dead. But he did. And that's our hope. We'll talk about that hope again on Sunday. And that reality. That Jesus is who he claimed to be. He did everything Messiah was supposed to be. And no one else could fulfill the prophecies and the promises of God the way Jesus did. He is our hope. He is our truth. He is the life. Polly? Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. So Matthew 27, was it? The darkness came from 12 to 3, basically. At 3 o'clock, Jesus died, which was the time of the sacrifice, which would have been the killing of the lamb for the blood for sins, putting over the door. If you go back to Old Testament. Jesus is the Lamb of God, sacrificed for us. And so lots of connections, lots of correlations, lots of little things through this. It's one of the reasons I wanted to give you all a chance to ask questions tonight or share statements. There's so much in this. I'm out of time, but I promised Dottie I would share something that she gave me, and we'll close with this. If you got more questions, we can hang out and chat a little bit. You can email them to me. I'll try to get back with you as best I can, as quick as I can. Try to answer as much as I can. But this comes from Turning Point, David Jeremiah's ministry. And it says, Wednesday, March 31st, the Ascension. Hebrews 9:24. For Christ has not entered holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. And then David Jeremiah says, preaching through the Bible sometimes results in important events getting little attention. An example is the ascension of Christ into heaven 40 days after his resurrection. One of the most important events in all of Christian theology. But going verse by verse through the New Testament means you only encounter three references to this important event. In Mark, Luke, and Acts. But an entire chapter of the book of Hebrews discusses the implications of the ascension. Christ entering heaven, the heavenly sanctuary, as our high priest and intercessor before the throne of God. That's Hebrews 9. We should take great joy from the ascension of Jesus and contemplate what it means for us. As our high priest, Christ presented himself to the Father and secured the eternal redemption of his church by his own blood. As our intercessors, Christ stands between us and God the Father, defending us from Satan's accusations. You are saved and remain saved and sanctified because Christ ascended to heaven. Praise God today for what the ascension of Christ means in your life. Saved, sealed, sanctified, and secured forever. Astronauts sink into insignificance beside the ascension. That was from Vance Havner. But just a quick word from David Jeremiah to be shared with us. Dottie's going to share with those of you who are here live some scripture verses. And I'm going to close this in prayer. And if you're with us online, remember our schedule for Sunday, 7:30 outside sunrise service. We'll do communion together have a service outside. 8:15-ish, we'll have breakfast. We're going to let the praise team go first, and then the rest of us will eat. And then 9:15 Sunday school, and 10:30 corporate worship in the sanctuary. You should park in the parking lot. That's actually a good question, because Larry's basically asking where are we going to do the service outside. We will probably do it on the right side of the building so we can see across the field. So if you'll come in the Van Buren parking lot and park just on the east side of the parking lot, we'll have some chairs available and set up. We'll either do it under the drive-through, or we'll do it kind of toward the road over there where you can really see the sunrise good. That's the plan anyway. If you want to bring your own chair for comfort, you can. Otherwise, you can set one of our metal chairs that will be cold outside and uncomfortable. All right. Let me pray for you, and then we'll dismiss. Thanks. Good question. Lord, we thank you for our time together this evening. Thank you for the Passion season. Thank you for the resurrection of Christ and the celebration we have, the hope that comes in Jesus Christ. And help us to remember, as we were just reminded, each of these events are important far beyond the one or two verses or chapters that are given to them. But this has changed all time and eternity. So Lord, thank you, and help us not to neglect these truths. Lord, just help us to meditate this week and to be thankful for all that you have done, all that you were willing to do, but mostly for the completed work of salvation. Help us to serve you faithfully as your disciples and apostles did, because you are a worthy God. And Lord, help us to share this good news with others as we come and go. May you be glorified in and through our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for being with us. We'll see you next week. Don't forget your cards from Dottie if you're here with us live. If you're online, see you soon.